Hi everyone, and welcome to our Exploring English Language and Culture Facebook Live. We're going to be here for the next half hour to answer all of your questions about UK culture, language, and more in connection with our FutureLearn free online course, Exploring English Language and Culture. I'm joined by Chris, Sally, and Tina. Hello, all of you.
Hiya. Hi, everyone.
And like I say, we're here to answer all of your questions, talk about anything you'd like to know about the UK, especially the subjects we look at in the course, which include music, literature, the countryside, and of course, the English language. Let's go to Chris first to hear just a little bit about the course and a little bit more about what I was just saying there. What's it all about, Alfie?
Well, you've just told us what it's all about. It's a great course. It's absolutely free. It's 4 weeks long, and in each week we'll talk about a different part of the culture in Britain. So for example, in week two we'll talk about music, but it's great because what we do is we ask you to tell us what you think about British music, and then we'll give you some information and listen to your opinions and to you. And then at the end of the week, we'll ask you to recommend something from your country. So next week, we'll ask you to recommend a song from your country, or we ask you to recommend books from your country, or to tell us about the countryside in your country, and show us photographs of places, and share videos of your favourite songs. So it's great. We tell you about the UK, and we ask you to tell us about where you're from.
Mm-hmm. Great. We've got lots of people joining us already. I'll tell you where from in a moment. Just while I have a look through all that list, Sally, tell us a little bit about what let's try again. Tell us a little bit about what's been happening this week.
Okay. Well, there's just loads. There are loads and loads of people on the course, which is fantastic. And this week it's about English as a global language, and people are talking about their experience of learning English and about how their ideas of English have changed. Some people said English was their favourite subject at school. Other people hated English, but now they really like it. And there's loads of fantastic conversations. Like, there's one conversation I saw, there's somebody from Italy, somebody from Brazil, somebody from Abkhazia, which I didn't know where that was, which is like a teacher's dream, basically, because from a selfish point of view, everybody's speaking in English and talking about what they want to say in English.
That's a good point. That's a good point that you have to use English on the course, otherwise you can't really take part. So it's a great way to practice your English and to talk to people whose first language is different from yours, and the way you communicate with them is through using your English. So it's a great way to learn and practice.
And as you've seen, I've been flashing some of the many countries that we've got joining us today already. And there are so many already. We've had Sudan and Myanmar and Indonesia and everything else. Ukraine, Slovakia, which is where I am at the moment. Sri Lanka.
Which is like the course. There are people from all over the world on the course, which is fantastic. And all people with different levels of English as well. So there are English teachers, in fact, and there are people learning with a lower level, people with higher level, but here for different reasons.
Mm-hmm. So as I said, so we're here to answer any questions that you might have. So any questions at all that you want to ask, just pop them in the comments. This comment just from Mariella here is perfect because it leads into our first question. Marielle is saying, nice to see you guys. Greetings from Chile, but my heart is in the UK. Because our first question is, can we understand British culture without having lived in an English-speaking country? That's a good question, I think. I know my answer, of course, would be yes, and I'm sure yours would be too, but how, why? Tell us more. Tina, you want to start because you're the only person who hasn't spoken so far.
I know, but I actually didn't listen to the question. Can you repeat it, please?
I don't understand British. I
mean, there's nothing. It's like blank. It's bizarre. So I can't actually see.
Can we understand British culture without having lived in an English-speaking country?
Am I allowed to say yes or no?
You are allowed to say anything you want, yes.
Yeah, because I don't know, it's the same for me. So I live in Italy. Mm-hmm. And so I think learning the culture around me really helps me with the language. So mm-hmm. I think it's a great thing to have and to be able to do. And I think what our course actually helps with is sharing a little bit of the culture. So it gives people ideas of what it is actually like in the UK. I don't know, really. I think it's a bit of both.
Okay. Let's go to Chris and see what he says.
Yes, I mean, you can understand the culture without living in an English-speaking country. And it's easier now than it's ever been because of the internet. So, you know, I have been to the United States now, before I went there, I had a strong idea about American culture because I'd read a lot of books by American writers and, of course, mm-hmm. seen a lot of TV and a lot of movies. So there's lots of access, you know, so you can watch TV from the UK, listen to music from the UK. That's a way of understanding the culture. Yes, you can understand the culture, but there's nothing quite like living in the country to get a really good understanding of the culture. Do you agree, Sally?
I agree. I mean, if you can go to the UK, you know, I mean, obviously, if you study English and you study all these things and you do become interested, you really want to go someday and see it and visit it and experience it firsthand. But as you said as well, technology is so great now. I mean, you know, we're so surrounded by things we can really immerse ourselves in so much if you really want to. Sally, what were you going to say?
No, I agree totally. And you can also meet British people online as well. So you don't, you know, a big part of the culture obviously is the people. So you can actually meet people. Although you're not going to see them in their sort of home environment necessarily, but you've got access to people as well. Oh well, you're at home in Slovakia though, Neil.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But it's a little island of Scotland in Slovakia.
That's the same for all of us though, isn't it? Except for Chris. So the three of us live in another country. We don't live in the UK. But if you came to my home, you would see a lot of British things in it, especially food.
I'm just noticing that Manuel in the comments says it's impossible, that immersion is a must, that you have to live in a country. I disagree, Manuel. I think it's definitely possible. I mean, to not understand it in the same way as living there, but you can get an understanding. But the other thing I want to say is is to ask another question, a different question, is do you need to understand the culture?
Are you asking everyone?
Yeah, I'm asking you. Because I don't think you do need to understand the culture of the UK. It's nice, but you know.
Yeah, I would agree. No, Sally, after you.
No, I was going to say it depends what you want. If you're learning English to understand the culture, or if you're learning English for business or to do medical research, then maybe you don't need to understand the culture, the British culture. Mm-hmm. You know, you need it for a specific thing. Tina's got her hands up.
Yeah,
Tina.
Can you just mean by the culture?
Exactly. Good. Yeah, that's a good question as well. Too big a question. I think we should move on. But you're right.
I know where I live, even if you just go 40 minutes away, it's very different and they do different things. And it's the same in the UK, isn't it? So how, you know, culture is such a big...
That's true. Yeah.
There are differences, but there are also a lot of similarities that I think people share, you know, as well. But yeah, I mean, as Sally says, I mean, if you're only learning English for your work, and let's say your job is to communicate on with regard to IT networks with people in 10 different countries, you know, it may not be important for you or useful for you or interesting for you to know anything about UK culture. It's just a tool to get your work done within that. But I think that, you know, with any language, I mean, as I think Sally said earlier, it's the people as well. And I think with any language, it's a richer experience if you do experience aspects of the culture, whether it's art or literature or music or cinema or any of the things we talk about there.
Join the course for more information.
And then you can decide. Yes, you know, how you feel about it. Lots more people joining us. I'm just going to give a few more shout outs to some different countries.
Lots of interesting comments.
Peru, Albania, Vietnam, Sri Lanka, lots more. US, Tunisia. Okay. Let me just have a quick look through the questions that are coming in before I go. Marcella is also kind of agreeing with the other comment you mentioned earlier, saying we can understand, but the feeling is missing. Okay.
Yeah, I get that.
But then on the other hand, Akash Campbell saying, if you're a literature student, then you can understand the culture as well. And that's true. I think that's what Chris was saying earlier. I read nothing but American literature for most of my youth. And, you know, I think I never went to America until I was like an old man. But, you know, I kind of felt close to the culture because of all of that. Okay. Jack Harris Edward is saying, I think we can understand it from the internet. I'm kind of on his side with this. Mm. Okay. And Renata, there's lots of discussion on this one. Renata saying it's much easier if you're living in the country. True, but nowadays with technology, you can learn so much, which I think is pretty much their position. Okay. Lots of people still saying hi. Haven't got too many questions yet. Let me just scroll down. Okay, let me go to another question from the course at the moment while I'm looking at that. Popular one. Does tea time really exist in Britain? I think we, again, as Tina said about culture, I think we perhaps have to talk about what tea time is as well, because it can mean different things. Some people think of afternoon tea, and some people think of tea time as it was in my childhood. So who wants to talk about this? Both of them. Sally, over to you.
I think we should just recommend a different course. We have the perfect course.
Chris, what's that course then?
Well, the course that will answer all of your questions about tea time is a different course. It's called Exploring English Food and Culture. And in that course, we talk about what tea time might be and when it might be. So we'll put a link to that course in the chat here. Sorry, I interrupted.
In the meantime,
that's right. It starts in November. That one.
Okay. Tea time.
Oh no, it doesn't start in November. It's running now, isn't it?
That's a long time to wait for a cup of tea.
Yes.
Okay, so where I grew up in the north of England, tea time was tea meant your evening meal. Hmm. So it was the meal that you had in the evening. But that's not the same in all parts of the country, is it? So we had breakfast, dinner, and tea. So tea, that's, but I think tea time, I think this is asking about the 5 o'clock tea.
Drinking tea. Because when
a cup of tea, yeah.
Yeah. Because tea time was now that I'm middle class, it's what I would call dinner time.
Yeah.
Yeah, in a few years more, perhaps you'll call it supper time.
Exactly, yeah.
So go on, Chris.
To answer the question, no, I don't drink tea at 5 o'clock. Mm. I drink tea all day, but I don't stop especially for tea at 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Tina, how good for you?
Sorry, that's the cat. To go out, if you can hear the cat meowing. I know I was going to say we had tea time when we were kids, and it was when we used to come in from school, and it was about 4 o'clock, and my mum would have we didn't actually drink tea, but we might have sort of a piece of cake and a glass of milk, and she'd have a cup of tea. But now, as Chris, like Chris, I drink tea all day, but we don't have tea time like Sally. We have dinner time, so we eat dinner later on. But then I'm from London, so that's the difference, is it?
Yeah, I think it is. I think it's a north south thing and a class thing as well, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, because you're posh.
Yeah,
well, if my dad saying posh. I don't know. He'd turn in his grave if you're allowed to say that.
I don't know. Coming home from school to afternoon tea is quite posh.
but there is an afternoon tea as well, isn't there? It's a thing. Yeah. Afternoon tea, or it's you can go to a cafe and have afternoon tea, can't you? Where you have tea, different types of tea or juice or something, or and cakes and little cucumber sandwiches.
But do you ever do that? I mean, that's the kind of thing that you would take your elderly mother to as a treat, right? It's not.
I was just about to say that I do it. If sometimes when I go to London, I do treat myself.
Exactly. But you are very similar to my elderly mother.
Same beard, yes. Okay. Right. Moving on. We've now confused the whole world about lunchtime, dinner time, tea time, and afternoon tea, but that's fine. Yeah. We can, what's the word? We can demystify this on our Exploring English Food and Culture course. I just have to pop this comment up for a moment from Vincent Poe, because we've been talking about regions and class and accents and things, and Vincent's saying, Sally, I admire your voice and accent. Sounds so good to me. Is that RP? Is that RP, Sally?
Well, thank you, Vincent. That's really nice that you say that. In fact, my accent is not RP because I'm from the north of England, so... I don't know. One way you can, an easy way to tell the difference is the way that we pronounce bus. Because Tina, for example, who's more RP than me, would say, what would you say, Tina?
Bus. Sorry.
Well, only when you're taking the mickey out of me.
Bus.
I would say bus. So I pronounce the U sound as
A difference between and U. Yeah.
So and I've got a northern accent.
Of course. So mine is not RP either. And neither. Tina's probably closest, I guess. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm northern as well. So my accent is not RP.
Sorry, I keep interrupting. I was going to say, I don't think Tina's quite RP.
What do you mean?
Not quite.
No, I don't think she'll be getting cast in The Crown anytime soon. That's true. But the good news for people watching, if you can understand all of us, you know, we're all from different places, from Scotland, from the north of England, from the northwest, the northeast, and from the south, from London. And we all have different accents. And if you can understand all of us, then, you know, you can be very happy, I think, about your skills. Okay. Question from Nwinti Tu Huang. I'm afraid of making mistakes when talking in front of other people. How can I remove my inner fear when speaking English? This is a good question. I think everyone
nice question, yeah.
sympathizes with that. Chris, you want to start then?
Well, I saw somebody else in the comments, and I don't know who, talking about in the comments about talking to yourself. And you know, that's something that we often recommend, isn't it? That you just practice on your own. It might feel a little bit strange at first to be talking, you know, to yourself in English, but it's good practice. And the second thing, the second piece of advice I would give is nobody minds if you make mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes, and it's normal, and people don't want to laugh at you. They want to help you. They want to understand you. So nobody is judging you unless you're in the IELTS test, in which case, yes, they are judging you. But nobody is judging you about the mistakes you make. They just want to communicate with you. So, you know, that's the most important thing. Communication is the most important thing. So don't be afraid. People aren't laughing at you. They want to help you. And they will help you. And it's the only way you can learn is by making mistakes.
Mm, yeah, absolutely. Sally or Tina, you want to add to that? Anything?
I think you have to pretend that you don't have an inner fear and you just have to do it. Because to be honest, I still have an inner fear when I'm speaking a language that isn't my own. But
everybody does, I think.
Yeah. So even if you try and sound confident, then you'll just do it and you'll be fine, basically.
Yeah, I think until you become absolutely fluent, until you've got that unconscious kind of mastery of a language, which, you know, is very difficult to reach and takes many years. I think everyone has that kind of, you know, self-consciousness, I think, at least.
We've got some really good resources. Is that what you're going to say, Tina?
No, I was going to bring back to the course, actually, and say we actually have a step next week, don't we, and we ask everyone to have a sing-song. So, we use a, is it Vokaroo, isn't it? Called Vokaroo, yeah. That you can actually record yourself, so that you can even try that to listen back to yourself, because I'm the same as Sally. I still have problems hearing another language coming out of my mouth, if you like, and it's very strange. So it's really good to record yourself and listen to yourself, because the more you hear yourself, it actually feels natural rather than feeling really alien. That's fine.
Sorry, Sally. Go on.
All right. I was just going to mention our resources on Learn English, where I've got these really good activities for speaking that really help build confidence. The listen and repeat activities, and we can put a link to those, I think.
Yeah.
I was just going to mention some of the comments Mercedes makes me laugh by saying, people will help you unless they are part of a plane crew. Mercedes has obviously had a difficult experience with people.
Well, yeah, I could give many examples of that. That's true. But I think the most important thing for me is what Chris said, first of all. I mean, and I always say this to my students, in real life, you know, not in the classroom or IELTS, but in real life, if you're speaking in English to somebody or any language, they're interested in what you're saying. You know, they want to know what you're saying. They're not interested in whether you've used the correct preposition or missed out any articles, or if you're only speaking in the present tense. They really want to understand what you're saying. And, you know, so I mean, it's, you're worried about it, but the other people are not worried about it more. So like Chris and Sally were saying, you know, just try to put it out of your mind and not think about it, and just focus on communicating what you want to communicate as well as you can. And you can worry about, you know, if it was right or wrong afterwards, or if they, you know, how that goes. Okay, let's move on. Just a comment here from Miranda. Reading poetry is a good way to learn. Absolutely. Yep. I agree with that. Also other forms of literature, short stories, you know, everything. And that's something we look at in week 4 of the course. And that's well worth looking at there. Okay, moving on.
So we're really a question from Luda asking if it's okay to criticize your boss in a polite way in the UK. That would be an interesting question.
Do you mean to their face? It's a good question.
Yes.
I don't think that's necessarily a UK thing, but I mean, I think it's about a company kind of organization culture and stuff. There are some companies that encourage honest feedback and honest kind of things like that. And there are other companies where you would never dare to say anything. I don't know. What do you think? Do you think there's anything?
I would never criticize my boss.
Yeah, but it may be that there's nothing to criticize your boss for, you know, sometimes that happens.
Chris is my boss, in case anyone didn't know.
Okay, lots of people talking about making mistakes and commenting on that. We'll come to that in a minute.
Yeah, there was a nice comment about dealing with fossilized mistakes. You know, when you mispronounce something for so long that it becomes very difficult to change your pronunciation. I don't have the answer to that question,
it can be really good to do a course then, can't it? I think when you've got to a certain level, and or at least have someone kind of correct you when you have become sort of fossilized at a certain level, or you know, you make those same mistakes again and again.
Yeah, and people are saying that it's fine to make mistakes, but you need to know that they're mistakes, so which have might be recording yourself, as Tina said, or having taking a course, as you say.
Yeah. I'm just going to pop this up, just going back to something else, because Jack Harris Edwards put an interesting comment here saying, tea time is also part of our culture in Indonesia. We have it in the morning and afternoon. It's the time to sit together with the whole family, having tea and talking to each other. It's a nice time. That does sound nice, and I wish we did still do that.
Yeah.
We do. We have coffee. Does that count?
Coffee time.
Yeah, well, I often go for coffee with my family, actually, but it's not exactly British culture, but it's nice.
Right, going to move on from coffee and tea and being worried about mistakes to a different topic now from Renata Braga, who's saying, what about trying to brush up my intonation and stress on words? Not talking about my accent, of course. That's a very good point, because a lot of people, we have at least 5 or 6 questions of people asking about British accent and how to get a British accent in the comments. For me, the most important thing is what Renata's saying here. Stress and intonation are really what affect understanding much more than accent. So what would you say about this, about how to improve it, how important it is, and so on? Who would like to say a little bit about that?
Well, I'll just mention again what Tina mentioned about singing next week, because it sounds strange, but on the course we ask you to sing a song for us. You don't have to, but it's great if you do, and to record it and share it with us. And actually, I think that singing is a great way of working on stress and intonation, singing songs in English. But yeah, I agree, Neil, and I agree, Renata, that your intonation and stress is really important in communication. But it is something, especially Renata, you're in the UK, you've told us that you're in London, I think. So just listen to people, and if you have that opportunity, if you're not living in an English speaking country, then TV, films and things, just listen to get a feeling of how stress and intonation work.
Mm-hmm. And sentence stress is something that people don't focus on enough, and it really makes a huge difference. When I first taught classes in Spain, it was so different for me, coming from like Slovakia and Asia, where I was dealing with things, and I had real trouble understanding just because of the stress pattern. It took me a lot longer to kind of tune in to what people were saying, and I found myself having to say, sorry, could you say that again, more than I'd ever had to before, and just because of stress. Sally, you were nodding there. So.
I was not, but Tina, you were going to say something, weren't you? I think.
I was going to say about lyrics training. That we could share a link. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, because just that Neil's showing me his ear, that so I wasn't sure whether he could hear me. We can share which is a great resource called Lyrics Train, and that's all to do with music. And there's, I think, 3 different levels, and it has activities, and you watch YouTube videos, and you can join in. And that's a really good way of helping you things like that, stress and intonation, still listening to the music, but also actively doing something in English.
Sorry, carry on.
We keep doing it today, don't we? Sorry, it's me. I was just going to say something that I found useful is to, when you learn a new word, for example, just to underline the syllable that is stressed, for example, in a word. It's a really simple way to help you remember the word stress. And you can do the same thing with sentences as well, but it's a bit more complicated.
Well, actually, you mentioned earlier, Sally, the speaking videos on the Learn English website, and they're really good for that, because they're natural, everyday work kind of situations, things that you would meet, and it is, you're repeating, you're kind of taking part in this dialogue in this kind of way by listening and then saying it in the same way, and it's a really good way to hear the difference, hear what it should be, and then practice, you know, immediately in that space and kind of try to get the feel, the rhythm and the intonation and the stress just right. They work really well. Okay, moving on. Just a quick comment from Jack Harris Edward, who's saying, this is going back to us talking about not worrying about making mistakes. Jack's saying, quite rightly, if we have to speak in a formal situation that's different, we have to speak English perfectly. I don't know if you have to speak it perfectly. I mean, I've heard some fantastic speeches at the, you know, from people whose English has not been perfect, but has been very clear. But yeah, otherwise people will laugh at us. I hope not, but it could be. But in a formal situation, it is more important to prepare and to try to be as accurate as possible, of course. It's a different thing. And there you need to practice, you know, if you're doing a presentation, you would want to practice it a lot in front of the mirror or use your phone to video yourself and stuff to get it as good as you can. That's different. But everyday conversation.
I think I would say that, Jack, the in a formal situation, you have to communicate perfectly, which is, you know, so you really need to get exactly what you want to say across to the audience. But that doesn't mean that there won't be a single mistake. It's about communication.
Okay, question for Chris here. Because I think he's the only person who's passionate about this topic among us. Maybe I'm wrong. Leuda's saying, even if football was invented in the UK, as far as I know, which sport can be called the national one when all the nation or almost all the nation watch TV in the UK? So I guess the question is, you know, what sport would bring everyone together to watch, you know, or to be, you know, most that would touch everyone? It is football, isn't it, wouldn't you say?
I think football is the national sport, but I'm not sure that it brings people together. Maybe the opposite. What do you think, Tina? You went to a football match recently in summer.
And we didn't bring it home, did we? I actually think it is football, to be honest. But I think when it's when we go to another country, so rugby sevens, maybe people come together when they're a bit more passionate about things like rugby or cricket. But Olympics, but I don't know, sport. I still think it's football, to be honest.
Sally talked about tennis.
I was just thinking of Wimbledon, which is a, you know, massive tennis competition in Britain.
That young girl recently who did very well.
Emma Raducanu. The American Open tennis.
Fantastic.
That was fantastic, yeah.
And it was lovely to see, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, personally, I enjoy tennis much more than football, I think, for watching. But I mean, I guess the top ones are football, tennis, and rugby, would you say?
No, I wouldn't say tennis. It depends. I mean, for watching, if you're talking about TV, then it's football, no doubt. Mm-hmm. And then if you're talking about playing, then it's something different.
Well, we at school, we used to do... Well, actually, the girls used to do hockey and rounders and tennis, and boys did football. That's what it was like when I was at school. It's probably changed massively now.
Yeah, don't start me on that. At my school, we were forced to play rugby, and I hated it.
Well, I played rugby. That was good.
We weren't allowed to play football. Jerry's just talking about the stress thing again. He's saying, I use a dictionary to find out the correct stress in the world, a word. For example, I used to stress the first syllable in the word photographer until I noticed that it's actually stressed on the second syllable. And yeah, absolutely good advice. Whenever you're looking at a multi-syllable word in English, definitely check it in the dictionary. And all online dictionaries now have the audio as well, you know, whether it's Macmillan or Cambridge or Oxford. And you can hear the word as well every time that you want to check it. And yet many people mispronounce the word or put the stress in the wrong place with photographer.
It's a classic.
Yeah.
But don't forget about sentence stress as well, about, you need to know the stress of individual words like photographer, Mm-hmm. But it's good to practice sentence stress as well.
Okay. Renata and Rasika are already saying they're ready to sing, so that'll make Tina happy on the music step. Okay. This question is tailor-made for our course, I think, from Irshad. How to improve vocabulary? Tell us. I'm just going to leave it open for the first person to speak.
Okay. Shall I go?
Yes. I knew you would.
Okay.
I knew you would.
Loads of ways to improve vocabulary. Reading is really, really good for improving vocabulary. And we've got lots of recommendations of things to read on our course. Was that, it's in week 4, isn't it? The week that's all about literature. I don't want to say all the things, but so somebody else chip in. So reading, that was my contribution.
Reading's my number one. I mean, for sure. This is also, I mean, I find what really helps me now quite a lot is subtitles on movies, because when I go to the cinema here, you know, they're in English, but the subtitles are obviously in Slovak. And I find myself reading the subtitles, and I just, you know, I'm quite happy because I recognize, I know, I understand. And sometimes I just learn phrases that I didn't know, you know, that come up in a movie, a natural kind of English phrase, and it's translated there. And I'd never heard it before. I didn't know it. And it really helps, you know. And now with, you know, Netflix and everything and all these things, you can do that and, you know, have the subtitles in English and listen in your own language and things like that. And watching English and listening in English. Chris, more?
I have nothing to add. I think you've got the two things. Reading is, you know, reading, I think, is the key to... Tina's got an idea. I think reading is the key to vocabulary. Reading is the key to lots of things with learning English. And it's fun as well. But the subtitles idea is great. But let's hear Tina's idea.
Mm-hmm. It's not an idea. It's just to say that we have some fabulous resources, don't we? On our learning English, and you can even flashcards if you really wanted to, with pictures and words, which I find I'm that sort of learner, so I really like pictures and words together. That's how I learn. Learning English Teams and also on Learn English, we have lots and lots of vocabulary exercises, which is another good way of improving your vocabulary.
Okay. We seem to have an awful lot of potential students for our Exploring English Food and Culture course here. Because so many people are asking about food and coffee and cakes and everything. And Aozora Higuchi is saying, I just remembered the question related to tea time. Are there any differences between shortbread, cookies, and biscuits? I like this one because, you know, I'm from Scotland and shortbread is just, you know, it's part of our daily life.
DNA.
Yeah. A day is not a day without a piece of shortbread, you know.
Yeah, you are 40% shortbread.
Yes, you've heard of the gingerbread man. No, I mean, it's the shortbread man. But so differences. Well, let's start with cookies and biscuits. What's the difference between cookies and biscuits? Just who uses them, I guess.
I think, well, cookies and biscuits might be the same thing, and it's just a difference between biscuits being British English and cookies being American English. But also in the UK, a cookie is a particular type of biscuit, right? It's a big, round biscuit, maybe chocolate, maybe not. But that's what you get when you get... Tina, you're looking confused.
I am confused. I'm listening. Carry on.
No, I think he's done. Oh, no, there's more. Okay.
No, do you disagree? So biscuits and cookies are the same thing. Biscuits is British English. Cookies is American English. But also in British English, a cookie is a particular kind of biscuit. A big circular biscuit.
Yes. Yes. I mean, if you saw a cookie like in a shop or someplace, you know, advertised, yeah, it would definitely be a round biscuit with something in it, usually, I think.
Yeah.
Bits of chocolate.
Yeah, it could be chocolate or other things. Yeah. So basically what we're saying is cookies and biscuits are pretty much the same. Cookies is more common in American. We use cookies in British English for some types of biscuit. And of course, chocolate chip cookies are always chocolate chip cookies. No one ever talks about chocolate chip biscuits, I think. But shortbread. What about shortbread? Yeah. Who's
tell us about shortbread, Neil. What is it?
Okay. I was hoping you were going to ask me that. It's a traditional Scottish kind of biscuit. And the thing about shortbread that makes it different from most other biscuits is butter. It's got a lot of butter. It's like, it's equal amounts of sugar and butter and flour together. And it gives this delicious, sweet, very crumbly and buttery biscuit, which is just fantastic. And, you know, we traditionally get them at Christmas, New Year. We use them for special occasions. And we always have shortbread in the house somewhere. Tina?
Does it have egg in the recipe?
I don't think so, no.
I don't think it does.
No, egg.
That's why there's a difference, because you tend to have egg in biscuits to hold it together.
Do you?
Maybe.
You should do our course, Neil.
Really?
I'm not a big biscuit maker, but I don't think I'd put egg in my biscuits.
Really?
I don't think there's egg in a custard cream.
If there's custard in it, there's probably egg, to be honest.
It's not real custard, is it?
I have no idea.
Well, that's interesting. I'll have to look into that, because I don't make many biscuits. That's true. I have made shortbread in the past, but okay. So
I have no idea whether that's true or not. I just thought I'd throw it in.
Right.
Okay. Well, Jerry is asking in the comments why it's called shortbread when it's not bread.
That's an interesting question. That's a very, very, why is it called short and why is it called bread? I believe, I believe that the short goes back to the things about shortening to do with the, but yeah.
Shortening, you know, bread, yeah.
Yeah, because it doesn't have egg in it.
Yeah, I think it's to do with the texture, and, you know, to do with the fact that it's crumbly like that. It's a different, the way that it's made, the ingredients make it in a different way from something that's like a dough. But I don't actually know the details of that. That's a good question.
Something to check out, isn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's good point. I've been eating it all my life, and I've never actually looked up why it's called shortbread. Just a quick comment.
All I know is that I really want a biscuit now.
Me too, and a cup of tea, actually.
Yeah. You know, you were saying something?
We also have shortcut pastry.
Yeah.
And I think that's the same Neil was saying. It's to do with the fat or the butter in it.
That makes it into this kind of crumbly kind of, different texture. Yeah. Just a quick comment from Albreza Inas. I find football a boring game. It's just like you watch two teams for nothing, especially if you're not beat for any one of them. I could say something about football in my country there, but I'll get in trouble, so I won't. Okay. Let's see.
I can relate to that.
Yes. Lots of draws. Lots of 1-1, 0-0 draws. I think we're coming up to our last question. Just another comment from Renata. That's a nice one here. I just want to say I watched another video about books. I think these videos, and I decided to learn about British culture after your chat. So I've got a Charles Dickens book right now. So that's good. That's what we hope happens with these courses.
Yeah, I'm reading a Charles Dickens book right now as well.
Which one are you reading?
I am reading Great Expectations because I've never read it, and I thought I should do something educational.
And is it meeting your expectations?
It's great. Yeah, no, it's good. It's good. I'm enjoying it.
That was painful. Painful. Okay, last question for today from Imtiaz. We've talked about vocabulary, we've talked about stress and intonation and pronunciation, we've talked about culture, and we've talked a lot about tea and food. But Imtiaz is asking, how can I learn the correct use of grammar? Chris or Sally? Either of you? Tina? Anyone? Who wants to come in here? Okay, we're going to go to Chris. We're going to go to Chris for this one.
Well, look, learning grammar is not something that happens step by step. Really, we teach it step by step, but you don't learn it step by step. You learn a language, the whole thing, and grammar is part of that. Now, we've got lots of fabulous resources to help you learn grammar, but if you just try and learn the grammar in separately, in isolation from the rest of the language, then you'll find it difficult. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, language is one part, it's a really important part of the whole thing of language, the vocabulary and the pronunciation and all of those other things. So you can learn to use grammar correctly and you can practice it, but don't worry too much about grammar and not worry about the other things that you need to be able to communicate in English.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Tina, you're laughing at me.
I'm not. I was laughing at Sally.
I was laughing at Tina. Because we're both drinking water.
Yeah, I mean, of course, grammar is important and you need grammar, but how you learn it, like you say, is also important. And in context and from, you know, from understanding and working with the language that you're looking at, rather than just looking at, you know, I'm going to study this grammar for this, you know, for why, because it's there, or because it's unit 3 of the book. Sally, what were you going to say?
Well, I agree with Chris, well, with everything you said, basically. But the good thing is that some, especially because Chris is my boss, but
and you're afraid to criticize him.
Exactly. But sometimes you kind of have to learn grammar because you might have to do an exam, even though we might not think that's the best way to learn a language. Yeah. It is a reality that some people have to just learn grammar for exams at school, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's a little bit mathematical in that way. But obviously you can't really use the language unless you can use it, unless you can speak it or write it. And you don't need the... Oh, I'm getting lost in what I'm trying to say. But basically, I agree with what Chris says, but I also understand that some people do need to learn grammar. Mm. And we've got lots of resources to help people as well.
But that's a really good point, and that sometimes studying to pass an exam is not the best way to learn a language that you want to use every day, but you have to do it, you know. So it's just a thing about memory.
I mean, I can give you an example. I always remember the very first book that someone gave me for Slovak language the title was something like Introduction to Basic Slovak. And the first 50 pages of it were detailed descriptions of the grammar. And, you know, you didn't learn how to say, hello, my name is Neil, until page 51. You know? It wasn't examples. It was an analysis and description of how the grammar worked and why it was there. I didn't learn anything at all. Honestly, I gave up before I got to page 51.
I remember that book. Yeah.
So Nikhil's asking, how do we get better at using grammar? Do we need to
learn all of them? Can we just use what's required only? That depends on your situation. I mean, you know, and what you're learning English for. If you need a certain amount of English, a certain type of English, and it's generally within an area, you know, that's what you need, then no, you don't need to learn, you know, the future perfect tense perhaps, because you'll never need to use it. But if you want to become absolutely fluent in the language, and if you want to read some of the, you know, literature or things like that, or if you want to, like someone said earlier, make, you know, formal speeches, presentations, things like that, then you're going to need much more. Do we need to learn all of it? I think I would say that you need to prioritize. You need to look at what's most useful, what's most frequent, what's most, you know, necessary, and focus on that, and other things maybe come later. I don't know. What would you say?
I think we as teachers, we need to know grammar because we need to be able to describe bits of the language. But as a student, you don't necessarily need to know, you don't need to know all the grammar, or you don't need to be able to describe all the grammar to be able to but, use the language to communicate.
But you know what? What I would also say as a teacher is that there are no shortcuts to learning a language. Okay, you can learn what you need, but you know when you see these things that say learn fluent English in 7 days,
yeah,
or your money back, that sort of thing, or you know these courses that promise you'll be fluent in 2 weeks of study, it's just not true because there is no shortcut. So it would be great, Nikhil, if you could just learn the little bits of grammar that you need and pretend and ignore the rest of it. But you know, languages don't work that way. So you can prioritize, as Neil and Sally have said, but there's not a shortcut. There's not a quick way to do this.
But I think the last sentence of Nikhil there, who's saying, can we just use what's required only? I don't know whether just is needed there, because the reason you need to understand grammar is because you want to communicate something that perhaps, you know, requires a more complex structure or language that goes with that. So the need will make you have to learn something. So what's required only, as you communicate more, as you want to communicate more, as you try to communicate more, and as you read more, listen more, and experience language more, then, you know, it will, I think, automatically become part of the process, part of learning.
Yeah.
That goes with that, you know.
And somebody was Sally? Somebody was I can't remember who it was. We had another live broadcast the other week, and we were talking about noticing in language.
Yeah.
So if you have been studying some grammar and then you read something, you might notice, that's the present perfect continuous that we studied. And so starts bit by bit, it starts fitting together. Like Chris said, it's not a short thing. It's a process, but it does, you do notice, or you can make yourself notice things that you read or language that you listen to and how it relates to.
When I'm teaching writing, I focus very much on that with my students. And, you know, when we've done something, I've said, okay, you've never studied this before. This is new for you. You've never thought about that. But now just go away and read these articles and you'll see, you know, so many examples of this all the time. Tina.
No, I go back to you said previously, Neil, about having subtitles on, because that's what I find. If, for instance, you've learned
grammar as well,
present continuous, you will start seeing that in the subtitles written in English. If you're watching it in your own language, you see it written in English. And the same in newspapers is another one, you know, with things like that. If you keep seeing, as Sally, it's basically, I'm repeating what Sally said, but you start noticing, hearing words that you think, oh yeah, that's what it is, or that's what it means, or that's past tense. Oh yes. And so in place. Well, that's what I find anyway.
Other way around as well. You notice something that you don't recognize, that you're not sure why have they done that? What is the reason for that? And then you can go away and explore and find out, you know, why is it written that way, not that way that I thought it would be, and things like that. Lots of stuff like that. Okay. We're way over time already. We still have lots of questions coming in, but we have to stop because it's tea time. It's tea time. I'm off to have some shortbread and a cup of tea, and it's almost exactly the right time, so I guess we were lying earlier when we said there's no tea time. Okay. So last messages from everyone. Tina, let's start with you.
Well, you've got to join the course. Whoever's watching today, we'll leave a link and join it and find us on the course. Come and chat to us and use English.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Tina? Tina.
Sally. Oh, Tina.
Me? This Tina?
Yeah. Tina too.
Good luck to everyone with their English studies. Thanks for joining us today. And anyone who has got an exam or a grammar test, then good luck, and check out our resources on the Learn English websites. There's a few of them, and the Teaching English website as well. There's loads of good stuff for teachers there.
Okay. And Chris,
and also check out our course about food and culture, where you'll find out lots more about tea and coffee and who drinks what and when and why and what they call it, all of that stuff. Thank you all again for all of your comments. We have to go now because any second now, my daughter is going to return from school just behind me.
So I should be expecting afternoon tea like Tina.
And cake.
Cake. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you study these two courses, Exploring English Language and Culture and Exploring English Food and Culture, you'll have covered all of our hobbies and interests and you'll have learned lots about Okay. Yeah. So thanks for all your great questions. We'll see you again for another one of these soon. Bye for now.
Bye.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Bye-bye.